viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. India is set to roll out fourth vaccine in the country after Indian drug maker company Cipla got regulatory approval to distribute Moderna's vaccine. India inoculated around 357 million doses by Friday. The majority of the vaccines given in India are by locally manufactured Oxford AstraZeneca's Covishield and indigenously developed Covaxin. Russia's Sputnik V has been the latest entry and is set to produce hundreds of millions by the end of the year.
After Covishield, Covaxin and Sputnik V, India is ready to receive its fourth vaccine. America's biotech company Moderna vaccine, that was one amongst the two used by the states to inoculate its citizens, will be a part of India's massive vaccination campaign too. The Moderna vaccine has shown efficacy of approximately 94.1% in protecting against COVID-19. WHO says the immunity starts to develop after 14 days of the first dose. Indian drug maker Cipla Limited has received regulatory approval to distribute it, paving the way for import in coming days.
New drug permission has been granted to Moderna. This is the first internationally developed vaccine for which now such permission exists today. And as I said, this new drug permission for restricted use, which is the other name for emergency use authorization, is now in operation. And this potentially opens up a clear possibility, clear likelihood of this vaccine being imported into India.
In a major ramp-up to the vaccination drive, India, which has so far administered around 357 million doses of different vaccines, administered 61 million doses in the last 2 weeks. It was more than the number of people who signed up for shots during the period, indicating an improvement in supplies after widespread shortages. The government has been working to enhance the capacity of manufacturing and is also planning to import others to meet its objective of vaccinating all adults by the end of the year. Meanwhile, Prime Minister Narendra Modi, while appreciating the efforts of the doctors on National Doctors Day, announced a credit guarantee scheme of $6.7 billion to strengthen the health infrastructure of the country.
ऐसे क्षेत्रों में हेल्थ इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर को मजबूत करने के लिए 50,000 करोड़ रुपए की एक क्रेडिट गारंटी स्कीम लेकर आए हैं जहां स्वास्थ्य सुविधाओं की कमी है.
India is treading carefully after the massive jolt it received in the second wave when thousands of them succumbed to the virus. And in a collective breakthrough, the country's caseload has come down to 500,000 from 3.5 million peak in mid-May. While some regions of the northern India where the positivity rate has dropped under 1%, the restrictions have been eased. Others like Maharashtra and Kerala with little higher positivity rates are keeping the controls tighter. Tourism industry, which received a huge hit due to the pandemic, is slowly opening too, with the government allowing travellers and revellers to visit places under a strict COVID-compliant protocol.
Moving on, Baloch have intensified their anti-PAC movement as they are now holding rallies across the major global cities against state-backed enforced disappearances in the region. And now, with COVID restrictions easing all around, they have pledged to escalate it further. Baloch accused that a PAC army-backed campaign has abducted and killed thousands of them in recent times for rightfully demanding independence from Pakistan, which had forcibly annexed the mineral-rich province in 1948.
Anti-Pakistan Baloch campaign is gathering traction and momentum as more people are joining in, taking to streets and demanding accountability into state-sponsored human rights violations. after London last week, a number of them gathered and demonstrated in different European cities against forceful disappearances by Pakistan. Unconditional release of political prisoners, including Dr. Deen Mohammad Baloch, who remains missing even after 12 years of his abduction, were the prime demands. Baloch leaders, most of whom are living in exile, say their prime motivation behind carrying out their events in the European and American countries is that their plights, which are not any lesser grave than other humanitarian crises across the world, have not yet found enough international attention and support.
So there are thousands of Baloch students, doctors, lawyers who are still missing in Pakistani secret torture cells. But the problem is that the international community is silent, and Pakistani establishment, Pakistani intelligence agencies, Pakistani ISI, Pakistani MI are enjoying the impunity and the silence by the international community.
In a bid to get a better shot at their objective, a similar protest was held in the UN city of Geneva, where the Human Rights Council is located. As per data collated by different groups and organizations, including UNPO, Unrepresented Nations and People's Organization, and the Voice for Baloch Missing Persons, the Baloch disappearance issue is not a trivial political issue, but a grave humanitarian crisis. Anyone who is deemed resistant to Pakistan's nefarious designs in the region is pegged. Subsequently, he is either imprisoned incommunicado or killed with impunity. Today, the region finds itself at the lowest in all performing indicators. Despite having the vast minerals and resources, the GDP of Balochistan is always hovering at the bottom. Pakistan has been plundering this region of its vast mineral and gas reserves for decades. But when people demanded freedom or even autonomy, or in some cases even a share, it resulted in the systematic annihilation.
Forces are taking the people and then there's a no whereabout of those people. Neither they are presented to any court of justice, nor their even family members. They do not know where are they and what they have done, for what they have been disappeared by force. And this is an activity which the Pakistani forces have been doing it from many years.
Activists also say that there has been a sharp rise in human rights violations in Balochistan since the launch of the multi-billion China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, or CPEC. They say it has brought only death and destruction, contrary to the promises of economic opportunities, employment and prosperity. CPEC is a network of roads, railways and energy projects linking China's Xinjiang to Balochistan's Gwadar port. They accuse Pakistani security forces have been given a free hand to eliminate voices against the illegal project. The Chinese government has spent nearly $70 billion on the project, and experts say there are no chances it is reconsidering its ambitions. So it is only the Baloch plight that is going to extend if international powers do not come to their rescue.
Moving on, the specter of Taliban looms large over Afghanistan, with foreign troops drawdown getting underway. And what could be called a spot-on forecast by experts, Taliban are making major headways with dozens of districts already under their control. The Afghan authorities are in a state of nerves with no real blueprint on the table. And while Washington has said that withdrawal does not mean abandoning Afghanistan, Kabul finds itself pressed to the wall. And amidst all this, former Mujahideen and civilians have vowed to fight the Taliban.
Parwan province in Afghanistan is now seeing some new armed fighters in its mountains. And they are not insurgents, nor any other terrorist group splinter, but former Mujahideens and civilians who have vowed to fight against the Taliban. They have picked up arms to save their country, and they will not let the Taliban advance even after the foreign forces leave. Among them, 55-year-old Dost Muhammad Salangi, who was also a Mujahideen, is leading an army of dozens in Ghorband.
در زمان قوت‌های شوروی سابق همراه احمد شاه مسعود غازی در جبهه و جنگ تربیت شدیم و آموزش و پرورش دیدیم تا هنوز ما در صفوف دولت هم هستیم بودیم و حتی بچه‌هایم هم در صفوف دولت قرار دارند.
Since the United States announced plans in April to withdraw its troops without conditions by September 11, after nearly 20 years of conflict, violence has escalated throughout the country as the Islamist Taliban seeks more territory. It has worsened, especially in the north, where Taliban insurgents have conducted a wave of offensive in recent days, moving beyond their southern strongholds. Intense fighting in the northern Afghan province of Kunduz killed at least 28 civilians. According to hospital officials, it injured 290 this week. Security convoys have patrolled the area in an attempt to keep residents safe from Taliban attacks.
ما به این آرزو نیستیم که کسی از برادران ما کشته شود ولی اگر بالای ما جنگ تحمیل کنند اگر به واقعیت بالای ما ظلم کنند اگر به واقعیت به مردم دست اندازی کنند مثل که در دوشی دست اندازی کردند به سیاست مردم به اموال مردم به ناموس مردم به دختر مردم اگر به این سیستم طالبان پیش برود به هیچ عنوان حتی فرد فرد تا افسالی بچه ما باشه مسلم شود در مقابلش استادگری میکنیم به خاطر چی به خاطر اینکه اینا دعوای اسلامی و دعوای انسانی و مجاهدت ندارند اینا یک دعوای تحمیلی
Though there have been meetings in the recent days and the Taliban say they are committed to negotiations, peace talks in Doha have largely remained stalled. Afghan President Ashraf Ghani with his former rival and top Afghan peace official Abdullah Abdullah have met US President Joe Biden to discuss the US troop withdrawal, but nothing seems to be working out as of now. The United Nations envoy for Afghanistan said this week the Taliban had taken more than 50 of 370 districts and was positioned to control provincial capitals as the country looked increasingly unstable. Chairman of the High Council for National Reconciliation, Abdullah Abdullah, said the country's survival was in danger now.
Salamat Afghanistan. Wahdat u yakparchagi Afghanistan. یعنی افغانستان اینمی مسئله به خطر مواجه شد خب بازم تکرار میکنیم که در این که راه بهتر از صلح وجود نداره وقتی که خداوند حرف تکمیل کرده که با صلح خیر مسئله ختم است
While Afghanistan has witnessed protracted war for two decades, observers say it finds itself at the most crucial juncture today. If Taliban recaptures what it had until 2001, before it was ousted by US-backed forces, then not only will the trillions of dollars be deemed wasted, but a return of hardline Islamic Sharia law will plunge the country into a constant cycle of chaos and instability, thereby paving way for another humanitarian crisis the world cannot afford to have.
And now in our section of Asia this week, the stories from across the continent that hit the headlines this week.
Hong Kong's active chief executive has claimed that the city has returned to order from chaos since China imposed a sweeping national security law on the global financial hub last year. The statement came after a flag-raising ceremony to celebrate the anniversary of the city's handover to China. Beijing imposed the security law just before the midnight on June 30 last year to punish anything China deems as subversion, secession, terrorism, and collusion with foreign forces with up to life in prison. It also included reduction in democratic representation in the city's legislature and various screening mechanisms for politicians. Major streets and parks where July 1 protests against the same law were scheduled were barricaded and cordoned off. People, however, came out in large number and demanded the restoration of the autonomy Hong Kong has had over the years. Soybean is a versatile food and one of the central ingredients of Japanese cuisine. It constitutes the basis of many distinctive Japanese flavors such as soy sauce, miso, and tofu. Soybean is also processed into countless Japanese culinary products. This factory in Saitama, north of Tokyo, still uses the traditional method of making soy sauce that was inherited 220 years ago by Fueki family. It aims to preserve the flavor and quality of their soy sauce through special fermentation process.
お醤油の原料は伝統的な醸造方法では3つです。まず 1つは大豆で、2つ目が小麦で、3つ目がお塩になってます。笛木醤油は江戸時代から変わらない伝統的な醸造方法を守って、でもろみを昔からずっと使い続けている木の桶で約2年発酵熟成させて、
The complex biological interaction between the ingredients during fermentation needs to be managed carefully, and at the right time, it gets the perfect rich flavor. It starts from steeping soybeans to decomposing wheat in a mold called koji to heating raw soy sauce in the tank before being processed into bottles. But the key in this traditional process is the wooden fermentation barrel. Soy sauce appeared in East Asian cuisine more than 2000 years ago. And now it is considered as most important Japanese condiment and is used to flavor all types of Japanese dishes. There are countless varieties and regional soy sauces that vary in flavor and color. Some of the typical types of soy sauces are regular all-purpose soy sauce like sashimi soy sauce, with lighter flavor and color so as not to overpower the flavor of sashimi, and there is even low sodium soy sauce for the more health conscious. Soba and udon are traditional Japanese noodle dishes that are very popular in Japan, but their great flavor isn't complete without some sashimi on top of it. It is the Japanese multi-use chili mix seasoning that makes food more delicious by enhancing the flavor. It can also be used with pickled vegetables, miso soup, grilled meat and fish. Sashimi means seven spices, and although the main component is hot pepper, it includes other ingredients that give an aromatic flavor and a beautiful smell in addition to the spicy taste. The story of sashimi started almost 400 years ago in this shop in Tokyo, where sashimi spices mixture were invented by Japanese merchant in the year 1625 to be used as a medicine that stimulates blood circulation to recover quickly after illness. But within few years of its production, it turned into a spice that is added to food. It is now produced by many companies, and the original shop still keeps old tools that were used when sashimi vendors moved between city and town to grind and sell their mixture.
その時代は将軍、徳川の将軍がいたんですけれども、三代将軍の家光の頃にですね、菊の御縁のご、あの菊の御縁の見切りというものがありまして、そちらの方で、献上したところ、ことのほか気に入っていただきて、あの山徳という、今うちでいうと八幻堀の上についている山徳の称号をいただきました。7種類を申し上げますと、黒ごま、みかんの皮、唐辛子が2種類入っておりまして、焼きの時間を長くした焼き粉、で唐辛子、本来のもので、あの赤粉、そして山椒、消しの実、朝の実と、この7種類で、構成されております。
Customers can buy the mixture in the same traditional package and also choose between three levels of chili strength in it. In 2013, UNESCO included traditional Japanese cuisine, or washoku, on the list of intangible cultural heritage. And with the spread of Japanese food around the world, the demand for Japanese sashimi spices, which is indispensable for obtaining the original Japanese flavor, has become very popular as well.
In culture is not just about gaiety and fanfare, but it is also about preserving the heritage and legends that have shaped it. Sikhism, one of the modern religions, is full of such epics. Today we take you to the holy city of Amritsar, where Sikh devotees gathered in large numbers to pay obeisance and mark the birth of 6th Sikh Guru, Hargobind Singh.
A pool of Sikh devout visited the holiest shrine of Sikhism, Golden Temple, in India's Amritsar city to mark the auspicious occasion of Prakash Parv, the birth anniversary of the Sikh spiritual leader, Guru Hargobind. On this auspicious occasion, the Gurudwara was lit up with colorful lights and its skyline was illuminated with fireworks. The devotees thronged the holy shrine, lit oil lamps and performed special prayers while recollecting the teachings of Guru. It is believed that Guru Hargobind played a key role in providing a new direction in religion of Sikhism.
ਅੱਜ ਬੜੇ ਚਿਰ ਬਾਅਦ ਕਰੋਨਾ ਮਹਾਮਾਰੀ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਗੁਰੂ ਘਰੇ ਦੇਖੋ ਕਿੰਨੀ ਸੰਗਤ ਹਜ਼ਾਰਾਂ ਲੱਖਾਂ ਦੀ ਗਿਣਤੀ ਵਿੱਚ ਨਮਸਤਕ ਹੋਣ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਪਹੁੰਚੀ ਹੈ ਜੀ ਗੁਰੂ ਮਹਾਰਾਜ ਇਸੇ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਹੀ ਆਪਣੇ ਘਰ ਦੀਆਂ ਖੁਸ਼ੀਆਂ ਸੰਗਤਾਂ ਵਿੱਚ ਬਟੋਰਦੇ ਰਹਿਣ ਬੜੀ ਹੀ ਮਨ ਨੂੰ ਸਕੂਨ ਮਿਲਿਆ ਇੱਥੇ ਪਹੁੰਚ ਕੇ ਆਤਿਸ਼ਬਾਜ਼ੀ ਦੀਪਮਾਲਾ ਦੇਖੋ ਕਿੱਡੀ ਵਧੀਆ ਸੰਗਤ ਬਹੁਤ ਹੀ ਮਜ਼ਾ ਕਰ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ ਆਪਣਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਹੀ ਆਨੰਦ ਲੈ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ ਨਮਸਤਕ ਹੋ ਗਏ ਇੱਥੇ ਆਤਿਸ਼ਬਾਜ਼ੀ ਬਹੁਤ ਵਧੀਆ ਹੋ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ ਦੀਪਮਾਲਾ ਹੋ ਰਹੀ ਹੈ ਲੱਖਾਂ ਪ੍ਰਕਾਰਾਂ ਦੇ ਹਜ਼ਾਰਾਂ ਦੇ ਲੰਗਰ ਚਾ ਰਹੇ ਨੇ ਗੁਰੂ ਘਰੇ ਸੰਗਤ ਪਹੁੰਚ ਕੇ ਖੁਸ਼ੀਆਂ ਪ੍ਰਾਪਤ ਕਰੋ ਮੈਂ ਸਾਰੀ ਸੰਗਤ ਨੂੰ ਕਹਿੰਦਾ ਵਾਂ ਇੱਥੇ ਪਹੁੰਚ ਕੇ ਗੁਰੂ ਘਰ ਦੀਆਂ ਖੁਸ਼ੀਆਂ ਪ੍ਰਾਪਤ ਕਰੋ ਸ਼੍ਰੀ ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਕਾ ਖਾਲਸਾ ਸ਼੍ਰੀ ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਕੀ ਫਤਿਹ
Born in late 16th century at Guru Ki Wadali near Amritsar, Guru Hargobind was the only son of the fifth Guru Arjan Dev, who was killed by Mughal Emperor Jahangir. Guru Hargobind propagated the idea of learning Gatka, a form of martial arts and weaponry to fight oppression. The practitioners of Gatka also emphasized that this form should never be misused. Guru Hargobind was the first Sikh Guru to engage in war and fought against the tyranny of Mughal Empire. He also created the Akal Takht, or seat of power at the Golden Temple. The number of devotees was relatively low due to the pandemic. However, the religious spirit was as high as ever.
ਬਹੁਤ ਵਧੀਆ ਇੱਥੇ ਨਜ਼ਾਰਾ ਦੇਖਣ ਨੂੰ ਮਿਲ ਰਿਹਾ ਗੁਰੂ ਮਹਾਰਾਜ ਦੇ ਕੋਰੋਨਾ ਵਰਗੀ ਮਹਾਮਾਰੀ ਚੱਲ ਰਹੀ ਆ ਅਤੇ ਫਿਰ ਵੀ ਸੰਗਤਾਂ ਹੁਮਾ ਮਾ ਕੇ ਆਈਆਂ ਨੇ ਇੱਥੇ ਮਹਾਰਾਜ ਦੇ ਦਰਸ਼ਨ ਕਰਨ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਗੁਰੂ ਰਾਮਦਾਸ ਦੇ ਘਰ ਦੇ
Despite having taught the community to resist and retaliate any aggression, Guru Hargobind's teachings' essence have been peace and harmony. Devotees believe his teachings are the source of inspiration for all, and his principles of humanity, secularism, and universal brotherhood would continue to guide the humankind on the path of righteousness.
Each Sikh Guru has enriched the religion with different set of values that devotees abide by in their entire lives. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.